this is the January 30th, 2017 meeting of the Committee on Public Works and Utilities of the Northampton City Council. We'll call the meeting to order, and I guess I should note that this meeting is being recorded. Would you like to call the roll?
Councilor Bidwell?
Here.
Councilor Dwight?
Here.
Councilor Murphy?
Here.
Councilor Nash?
Here.
Next on the agenda is public comment, and we do have a member of, would you, Mr. Vito, you have anything to say in public comment, or do you want to wait until we talk about
that? I think we should wait till we're on the agenda. Okay. I'm representing a company, not my own interest.
That's what I thought. I just wanted to give you the chance to make a comment as the public. Okay.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Next on our agenda is the election of committee officers. The history here, of course, is that when Councilor Adams, who was chairing this committee, resigned from the council, I was asked to sort of, as vice chair, step in and assume the duties of chair, which I've been glad to do. But Pam pointed out to me that, well, there's never any election. So since we do need to elect the vice chair, we might as well take care of both matters all at once. So that was the idea of putting it on the agenda the way it is. Before I ask for if anyone would like to move that we open nominations, any comment or discussion or background to be added? Okay. I would entertain a motion to open nominations.
Open nominations for officers of
the should we do them one at a time for
sure.
For chair?
Sure. So I would nominate Councilor Dennis Bidwell.
I would second that in a heartbeat.
Well, short straw, yo.
Hi.
if elected, I would be proud to serve. Are there any other nominations?
I move that we close nominations.
I'll second that in a heartbeat, too.
Okay, nominations have been open. There's a nominee, and it's been seconded. Any further discussion? All in favor of Mr. Bidwell for
Aye.
Okay.
I move we open nominations for Vice President of the Public Works Committee.
I would second the opening of nominations.
Okay, the nominations are open. Would anyone like to place a nomination?
Yes. I nominate Councilor David Murphy.
Mm. Councilor Murphy declines. He chairs enough stuff already.
I nominate Councilor Nash.
I second that.
When do we get to comment?
I move to the close nominations.
I second quickly.
All in favor of closing nominations?
Aye.
Okay, we have it. We have a nominee, and yes, I suppose we should give the nominee an opportunity to say anything before we administer the sentence.
Sure, I'll do it.
That was very stirring.
For me.
I'm saving the stirring stuff for City Council.
Well, thank you for stepping up. And it does come with the advance notice that there is an upcoming meeting when I expect to be at. But he
like the next 11.
But he I only told him about one. I told him there may have been a reference to at least. Okay, all in favor of Councilor Jim Nash as vice chair?
Aye.
Do I get to vote on these?
Yeah, you can.
All right.
Bad form if you don't.
It's bad form not to vote for yourself.
Okay, all right, well now I know.
Okay, so we have our committee officers now officially in place. Thank you.
Can I make a motion to approve the minutes of November 28, 2016?
So moved.
I'll second that too.
It's been seconded. Any discussion? Or I'll just comment that they're, as usual, really good and really thorough.
You.
And I went back and referred to a few things myself since it was November when we had that meeting. So thank you. All in favor of approving the minutes?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. So we're.
Oh, I wasn't here. No wonder they don't look familiar to me.
So we made a little bit of headway in our last meeting thinking about the topics that we might want to address in upcoming meetings, and those are reflected on our agenda, and we wanted to fine tune it a little bit. And I was asked to go talk to the mayor about a couple of these things, in particular, what his timetable might be looking like for water and sewer rates. And because I noted that last, at the meeting of this committee last February is when we had a public hearing. And I don't know if the mayor is going to be ready for a public hearing. That would mean they'd come to council first and then get referred. So I don't know if that'll all happen. So it's possible. Does anyone else have any more information?
I don't have any more information beyond my conversations with the mayor, which were before your conversations with him. So we
might or might not be doing a water and sewer rate public hearing at our February. The other item that there was interest in when we talked about this back in November was actually a couple of matters involving Columbia Gas. One, Columbia Gas has been quite responsive, beyond that proactive, it seems to me, in working with the community in Springfield and working with the DPW and the community here around the gas leaks issue. And so we've talked about inviting Steve Bryant in to talk a little bit more about that and what this means. Has this indeed become a model for the way it works in other communities? And the second item involving Columbia Gas was for an update on the gas moratorium. And I talked a month or so ago with Steve Bryant. He has the February date on his calendar and expects to appear. But it looks like we have a representative from Columbia Gas.
No.
Do you have any, do we need to formally recognize Mr. Vito?
I think for the purposes of expediency and given the crowd, I think it's
hold him back.
A presumption of recognition.
I don't
recognize him, send him back out of the parking lot.
So, Mr. Vito, would you like to introduce yourself and your role and say what you came here to say?
My name is Michael Vito. Many of you know me for many, many years, actually, having worked for the city for some years and covered the city as a reporter. And admiring these big TV screens that you have now.
Check
I haven't
out.
Seen them yet.
Yeah,
the chairs, things have really moved up since I moved on. So I do work for Columbia Gas. I am a consultant with them, working on community outreach. Also just a representative for them in the Northampton area. And you know, I talked to Steve about this meeting. He's excited about coming. He feels like he has a pretty good rapport with Northampton. And in my time in government, I don't ever remember a utility CEO spending so much time in a community of this size. So even better for everybody. But he just really wants to get a sense from folks on this committee about how you want to structure things. I mean, he's used to speaking at press conferences and things like that. Not sure if he's ever been before a city council before, because he normally works with the executive mayor or town manager. So this is a little new, and he just, you know, wants to do his homework so that he makes sure, you know, he knows what he can answer whatever you want and what format that might be.
Well, that's great. We appreciate his interest in coming forth. And yeah, it's a little new for us too. We're
right.
Making it up as we go along.
Well, this committee is fairly new.
It's brand new.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
This committee, that's right, didn't exist before a year ago.
Right.
The old Public Works Commission is no more.
Knew them well.
Yeah, so. So, well, just as background, the genesis of this idea was conversations with our DPW director, where she was keeping me informed or informally about the ongoing coordination with Columbia Gas around street projects and utility work, particularly gas work, and more particularly opportunities to address gas leaks when the roads are already torn up.
And replace old pipes.
And replace old pipes.
Right.
And then I've been sitting in on some of the community meetings led by Marty Nathan and the Two Degrees group, and they've been really drawing a lot of attention to the magnitude of gas leaks, including those that aren't considered dangerous to structures and people, but are nevertheless releasing very large volumes.
Right.
And matter of fact, Steve came to one of those meetings in Marty Nathan's living room, and he's been quite responsive. Seems to be taking a leadership role in a methodology for identifying and addressing such things. But maybe that's something you would, do you want to tell us anything about that, or do we just sort of structure how we'll have
just structure really come up? I mean, I'll certainly leave that to him.
I mean, I'm a little concerned, because that's not actually on the agenda, so
you're right, you're right.
Appropriate.
So this is to structure next month's meeting. Mm-hmm.
And to that point, as you pointed out, that normally Steve talks with the executive who has the authority. We actually have no authority as a council
understand.
Except for we're the information processing center, if
right.
you will. So I think it's essentially, as the chair described it, an informal description of ongoing projects and agendas, and also a discussion with the DPW head and how she works in concert with you guys. It's basically
so she will be here.
She has been invited.
Okay. Okay.
And to that extent, and actually we're limited as to what we can ask her as well under the new charter, that we can she can only respond to things that we've already given her advance notice about what it's going to be.
I'm one of the few people that did read through.
Yes, I know. If you were on the charter review committee, you would know. And it's informational for councilors to share with their constituents, particularly the councilor who has the most active ward relative to this issue.
Right.
And questions would be, it's not an interrogation, and it's more seeking information. So, and as you said, the relationship so far has been very above board and very transparent and very and cooperative.
Right.
And so I think it's just simply an update, if you look at
sure.
it that way.
So he would come in and basically give you an update on projects coming up in Northampton related to both the gas leaks or pipe replacement, maybe how they coordinate with the DPW on that.
Tell me if you think this would be helpful for purposes of Director LaScalia, if she accepts our invitation for she and some of her staff to come, and for Steve Bryant, and for Marty Nathan, to maybe just write up some questions so everybody has them in advance.
Yeah. You could certainly do that.
Because as Councilor Dwight says, this isn't any kind of interrogation.
And also know that in terms of that type of maintenance, there are people at Columbia Gas who work with someone who works for Donna. I don't think either of those two are the main participants in all of that. So I don't know how they would have to do quite a bit of homework on their own for that.
Are you suggesting that he might want to bring somebody with him?
He might. Yeah. It depends on how much information you would want.
Right. My sense is that we're not looking for any terribly technical detail. I think what's relatively novel about this is the initiative taken by utility in making some of these things happen. And the way it's been described to me is that Springfield, Northampton are sort of proving grounds for how this type of coordination with the city or town could be expanded.
Right.
And I think
have you spoken with other communities that are serviced by other gas utility companies like National Grid or?
Have I?
Yeah.
No.
Okay.
But I suspect there may be some differences.
Mm-hmm.
So in some sense, it's an opportunity for Columbia Gas to just talk about some of the novel things that they're doing, particularly as it affects Northampton and coordination with our Department of Public Works.
And I would expect there'd be an audience.
Yes.
So And I'm not sure how, we haven't structured how that.
Right, that was my next question.
Work.
So, well, I agree. So I hadn't, as I said, I'm kind of making this up as we went along too. So I don't know there would necessarily be a public hearing, because I don't know that there.
No, it can't be a public hearing because it's not announced and it's, there won't be a decision rendered.
Right.
Right. So we structured as inviting several folks to speak and to engage in a relatively informal conversation, I think, with an expectation that there would be other people in the audience, including possibly the press.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Though it would not be my expectation that somebody in the audience should be able to say, when are you going to fix the gas leak in front of 237 North Maple Street, and expect them to be prepared to answer that.
Right.
So to some extent, you know, encouraging the public to come thinking something's going to happen that isn't would be fraught with error, because we're intending to have a pleasant chat with the president of Columbia Gas, and I'd hate to have the public come think that they're going to get specific questions answered that they may, burning questions, bad metaphor there, but questions that they may have that we didn't set this forum up to solve.
And also, in conforming with the charter, we have to be careful because citizens want to address questions to Director LaScaglia, then that's problematic too, because
right.
It might not come with, it might be in violation of charter, which would be difficult to explain to a public that would, you know.
I'm here, she's here, why can't I ask her?
Well, we just have, and I'm sure you could help me on some ground rules, but questions are addressed to the chair and.
I mean, I like what you suggested is pre-written questions in some level. I mean, I think what you do is you have a public comment section where the public can speak to some of the points that concern them. Then pre-written questions have been directed to you, so Director LaScaglia knows first up front, and we can accommodate Columbia Gas too, I suppose, but we're not required by charter to. We can sandbag them if we want, but I don't think.
No, I would see it as
I think that's why Michael's here.
One document with questions that are particularly.
Yes.
Directed to
yeah.
the gas and some mm-hmm. particular DPW, some directed to the community group, but also some that everybody would probably yeah. just want to weigh in on.
I'm assuming if a member of the public posed a question and wanted to write it down and give it to us with an email, we could give it to you and somebody could respond to them
Absolutely.
In a reasonable amount of time.
Absolutely.
But they couldn't expect him to respond to it on the spot,
right.
but
right.
he could get somebody to researching it back to him.
So Absolutely.
They would get that level of satisfaction
yeah.
at least.
Yeah.
I mean, you're absolutely right. This is all new in the
right.
absence of a commission that actually exists.
Mm-hmm.
And we're still working out what's the best way, the most efficacious mm-hmm. way that this committee actually can provide the information that the council needs and requires.
Mm-hmm.
There's no pending legislation relative to this, but
mm-hmm.
this is for informational purposes. We also thought that this would be a convenient location for the public to at least get
yeah.
information
right.
as opposed to, you know, angry emails or
right.
Facebook posts. It seems
right.
like this is a better, more responsive give and take.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, that's essentially it. As the chair said, we're still making this up. So.
And the newness of this is indicated by the fact that the mayor understandably wants to understand the nature of
right.
our desire to have his DPW director here and is
sure.
careful about setting precedents and the charter and everything
mm-hmm.
else. Hopefully these questions written in advance would make everybody feel a little more comfortable
yeah.
with exactly what we're doing and what we're not doing here. So that would be my intent.
Okay. So how would you go about putting these questions together and getting them to us?
Well, I think from our from some of what I just said,
mm-hmm.
those are obviously some of the questions,
mm-hmm.
and you've heard me talk a little bit about what I would have in mind. But I would be interested in, I guess I would probably put together some questions,
mm-hmm.
Could share with one other member of the committee, maybe my vice chair,
right,
and then get it out to all three parties.
Great.
But what are there other thoughts on any specific
on questions that anyone would like to have.
Well, I'm thinking that the best questions are going to come from Marty Nathan's group, because they've really been studying this, and that we want to reach out to them and funnel the questions over to Columbia Gas. I mean, the question I have is there a two-sided thing going on, but it sounds like the groups are talking to each other, and that this is more like a way to bring that conversation into the public, that, you know, started in Marty's living room, and it sounds like it's positive, stuff's getting done, so maybe the simply questions rather, I just want to make sure that the other group, the LEAK group, is feeling like, are they going to want to have time to present something, or do they feel like through the questions they're going to get their side represented?
I think we probably want to give all three parties a chance to say a little something, but in particular to address specific questions.
And the third is DPW?
Yeah.
Okay.
DPW, the 2 degrees group led by Marty.
Well, maybe that's something we can determine by looking at the questions.
Yeah, so,
you know,
so what,
who do they think
they
are?
We certainly don't want to encourage 20-minute PowerPoint presentations.
No. The informality of this is going to have to be maintained.
And you have to keep in mind that it's a public meeting, so anyone, not just Marty's group, but anyone can come and speak to any issues. So then, Marty's group has been the most active and has generated the most questions and has actually prompted Steve's response. So that makes perfect sense, but at the same time, you have to recognize that this is a public forum as we open it up, but as such, we don't get to control the questions in that respect. I mean, the chair would have to control based on the parameters, you know, what Director LaScaglia has to respond to or not, and then you know, whatever reasons need to maintain decorum. I don't anticipate any problem with decorum, but you never know. Northampton. Michael's been in this room when it's hot before, but it's so.
No, and I think the public needs to understand that depending on the nature of their question, the answer may come in the form of an email later rather than general policy statements tonight, and we're happy to research your question and get back to you, but that's not going to happen during the course of the meeting. You know, everybody will get an answer, but some will get it quicker than others.
And I think an announcement from the chair to that effect at the beginning will be helpful.
If it's a complex or specific question, you may get an email answer later.
I'll confer with Council President Blake probably on some ground rules. You've been through this drill a little more, but I think that would be a helpful way to start off our session, and then we'll start to put some of these questions together. We'll confer with Marty Nathan, and Councilor Nash and I can look it over, and we'll distribute it to the parties, and presumably in the meantime we'll get some word from the mayor on whether his department people will be here. I would hope so.
Yeah, that would be something. So you do have a public comment period. Would you encourage people in Marty's group to speak then, or just for a sense of order?
I guess if it's germane to what we're later going to be talking about, I think it would make more sense for them to wait.
Just to give people a chance to have their say up front.
They'll have their say.
Within Robert's rules.
Does that sound okay as a way to proceed for that part of it?
If everyone's comfortable, then I'm fine with that.
And then the second item, which definitely does not involve DPW, is the gas moratorium. And there is some history here. We it was prior to my time, but this council did pass a resolution that I meant to go back and look at it before coming here, but I think it made reference to both proposed pipeline matters, or both proposed moratoriums, both moratoriums, rather. And I think the request was, give us some information that explains why this moratorium is so necessary.
Right.
I'm not sure that we as a council are really really did a lot of follow-up on that. But nevertheless, there is a history of council concern about the impacts of the gas moratorium. When I last talked with Mr. Bryant, he said that it was possible, and making no promises, that by the time we got to a February meeting, he might have some news.
Let's hope.
So whatever kind of update could be provided.
Yeah.
And if there's not some dramatic announcement, some indication of what remains to be done before
we could have breaking news right here on our stage.
We might.
Yeah, tell them to hold his fire.
Yeah, this is, you know, just so the council understands, this has been an issue for many years. I don't know if folks remember, and you probably do, Bill, that we had to put up, which is part of what I helped do for them, was set up a liquid natural gas facility over in East Hampton, right near the Northampton line, so that in wintertime, when there was such a high demand, they could put extra gas into the line from a liquid natural gas tank that was brought into the site. And, you know, they did get a little bit more, they got more capacity from Tennessee Gas, but this part of their system, the Northampton, East Hampton area, saw more growth than any other part of their system, whether it be Springfield, Brockton, or Lawrence. People just really, there was just a big, big demand for gas when oil prices unexpectedly went up so high when they did.
Right.
And that's why we're here, is to try and resolve that.
And there were some terrific incentives as well during that time to switch the gas.
Yes.
To the extent about the questions and stuff related to that, I think that those questions are probably, it's probably the response is going to be less structured than the first phase, talking about the progress towards addressing leaks. It's a stronger, larger, more philosophical discussion relative to sustainability and conversions,
right,
and construction and development, and,
right,
and the impact that it has. And it was also tied in with the pipelines as well, and so consequently carried with it a fair amount of controversy, we can say, without fear of challenge.
Well, that pipeline wasn't here. There was no direct correlation there.
There was a corollary made in a lot of people's minds, and at some point it was expressed that there was a cause and effect,
right,
or presumed that it was some form of hostage taking, basically. So with that, I think that'll be probably the color of the conversation that'll be in that respect. And I think whatever Steve can do to clear up some of the confusion, and then also give people some sense of
right. So
where things are headed.
When you're talking about this being Northampton, of course, the micro and the macro.
Indeed. Exactly.
And that's what I will
think. Well, I thought you would understand what I was saying.
Yes.
Yeah. Exactly.
Part of the micro is that just last week I was up at Village Hill talking with Mass Development about their timetable for selecting a developer for 85 units of housing up there, housing which at this point would not have the option of being serviced by natural gas.
Right. Right.
And it would be of great interest to Mass Development and any prospective developer to know, well, what are the chances of that changing?
Right.
So there's a lot of very real situations beyond the just sort of abstract that make this a very, very, very pressing issue. And it wouldn't surprise you to know that the Chamber of Commerce, from an economic development point of view, has had great concerns about the continuation of this moratorium.
That he's aware.
Yeah. So I don't know that we need any questions submitted in advance.
Right. No.
I mean, it's
right.
It's whatever he wants to say about how we got here, and is there a solution in sight, and what might the timetable be? But I think that And yes, if we should probably expect that there would be press here if
right.
there's any prospect at all of there being some some news about.
Right, and of course, you know, this being a negotiation, there are some elements that he probably would not be able to talk about.
Right. Okay. Anybody want to add to that? You can express our appreciation for his.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, it'd be nice to see the press again. We don't see them too often anymore.
You have to let them know. Have to let them know that it's happening. See if they.
So.
Times have changed.
Yeah, times have changed a lot.
Is there an order we want these to go in? I'm thinking we might want the leaks going first because that's going to be the biggest turnout. But I don't want to see the turnout bump the moratorium, which will probably have the lesser turnout.
Well, in terms of DPW count, Director LaScala and staff, I would also think do that first. Mm-hmm. And then move on to the moratorium so she and her staff don't have to stick around.
Okay. Yeah, I think you're correct that the moratorium is definitely more basic. I mean, it's just not as much there.
And you've already heard the questions. So, yes. You know what those questions are, so.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, good. Thank you.
So I think we're set. So. Is there agreement that even if, for whatever reason, Director LaScala cannot be here, I assume we still want to proceed and learn about this from the standpoint of citizens group and mm-hmm. the gas.
Steve can certainly give the gas companies, you know, general sense of, you know, how they're going to be going at this.
Yeah.
Maybe not street by street, but.
And they're in consultation with the DPW anyway.
Correct.
So they can convey their communications with the DPW. And if Director LaScala can't come, you might ask for a memorandum of some sort that.
Really, her only role in this is giving them permits to dig holes.
Exactly. Well, there are some.
She doesn't have a lot to do with this other than say it's okay to.
Well, it's also coordination with other projects, street rehabs,
yeah.
And stuff like that.
Right.
And it's the thinking, both parties thinking
right.
in advance and coordinating in advance before it gets to the, oh, wish we'd thought of that before we pulled
right.
the backhoe out. So.
Very true.
Okay. So, with or without a public hearing on water and sewer, we've got plenty to deal with in February. And then, if the public hearing doesn't happen in February for water and sewer, I assume it would in March. And contrary to this original thinking that might be in April, my sense is that in terms of the budget timetable, that's one of the first building blocks for the mayor put together a budget. So I think earlier in that process is when there would probably be the water and sewer public hearing, if not February, then March.
Relative to water and sewer rates and then the stormwater management would be different.
Stormwater would be totally different. Yeah. It's not clear to me what's gonna happen there. We had a at our last council meeting, a quite detailed presentation, update on the stormwater utility, its financial situation, and its projects completed, and its projects coming up. That was kind of what we wanted to get at when we started talking about having such a conversation here, and the whole council and the public have that conversation now. So I don't know what kind of conversation we would have here, or in what context, because we don't have authority over stormwater rates in any event.
Okay, I wasn't sure. You don't do stormwater?
We approve the enabling legislation. The fees, we can modify, we do have the authority to modify the fees, or if there's a variety of things that we do have, well, fiduciary oversight.
Right.
Insofar as an enterprise fund.
Right.
We don't have direct authority over how it can be prosecuted. So,
right. Okay.
Mm-hmm. I think the next big discussion in that area is it sort of is an agreement that it's capped at raising $2 million. Mm-hmm. I think if that cap were to go away, we'd get really, really involved in it. But I think that cap is more or less still in place. So,
but it also seems that despite the fact that there were 2 years of public comment discussion and actually public committees forming, creating the formula and everything else, there it's appropriate to have a refresher. There's a pushback in some in the community that's there's a loose organization that's actually calling for repeal, and I think it's an opportunity to have a discussion, at least to re-explain all the challenges associated with trying to establish some way to subsidize your stormwater management system. So, it wouldn't be terrible to revisit in a more concentrated form as opposed to another 2 years of a lot of PowerPoint presentations that we've gone through and a lot of discussion. But there's an opportunity to maybe reach out to some of the people who participated in that originally, the members who of that former committee that helped come up with the formulation, other people would be willing to talk about why this model instead of other models that, for instance, having it come out of the general fund in Westfield. Westfield does half general fund, I think, half fee. What was the reasoning behind making this a fee instead of a tax, mm-hmm. or something would come out of the general fund? All those conversations, they need to be revisited to remind people what it was. This was not done by fiat. It wasn't done, it was done with more transparency than I think I've seen a witness in any other law developments other than the charter. So
are you suggesting that we might use this opportunity to re-educate folks both as to the process, how we got here, as well as the substance of how it works?
I think it's possible that this, you know, as we cast around trying to find a purpose, this would be a good venue for that presentation, along with give and take, the same, similar to the discussion here. Right. It would be more involved and more elaborate and would require a lot more preparation, I think. But,
So what format would you imagine that taking, given where it
could be? If the mayor is amenable, along with the DPW having and then some members from the original committee that made the recommendation explain what the process is, what the challenges are, what the mandates are for. I mean, what, you know, the rock on the, I think it helps to have the rock on the hard place described. In a lot of people's mind, this was just sort of a whimsical thing that was established just to raise more money some way. I've seen some of the literature that's gone out about this, that the city is squandering grant money and loans that they already took out that could easily take care of all the issues that were being addressed. A revisiting of Donna's presentation in some more concentrated
some highlights
like that, costs associated with the mandates that are coming from the EPA, although who, if there will be an EPA in a few months, who knows, I don't know, but the refresher for everybody, it probably wouldn't hurt.
Still, yeah, because if the mandate doesn't go away, we still have to comply with
still
it.
To comply.
It was unfunded and there was no money in the budget. It's a lot of money, it's got to come from somewhere. This seemed like the most equitable distribution of the burden to the users, you know, people in the system. I mean,
and even if the EPA does go away, it doesn't obviate the very simple fact is that we rely on this stormwater management system to literally keep our businesses afloat downtown, no pun intended there. But if you don't get FEMA insurance, your bank's loans go into default, your business's belly up.
You just pay a lot more in flood insurance than you would have ever paid in the stormwater.
Right.
You know, this is spreading the burden around for a third of the city,
right.
So they don't get whacked with stormwater insurance.
Right.
So, but those are very nuanced and complicated conversations, and the decision was not an expedient one. I think the more that we can impart that this decision actually was a long, mm-hmm. thoughtful process that actually came up with something that is working that can be tweaked, and we have the authority to tweak it, but we have to be careful.
We don't want to give them the expectation it's going away.
I believe that it should not go away. I'm one. A few, I think so.
So just to play devil's advocate a little bit, what we're regarding as transparency and an opportunity to remind folks of the thoroughness of the process and everything else, and an update.
could also be regarded as opening up a can of worms.
No, I agree, but I also think...
That doesn't really need to be opened up.
I have a feeling that can's getting open. Someone's turning the can opener right now. And I think silence and ignoring something, hoping it goes away, at that point, then the rhetoric becomes more, more calcified, less nimble, and it starts to become, you know, the us against them thing. And I think that good people, good conscience, and good effort put a lot of good work into what's essentially a good structure. I think at least some reminder of that. And who knows, the paper might pay attention. I don't know, they might write a piece about it. And both pro and con. I think I have no problem with counterpoint arguments, but most of the arguments I've heard have already been vetted. We vetted those arguments long ago, fought those battles long ago, and the circumstances haven't changed.
Including tax versus fee.
Including tax, exactly. So in that respect, opening that can of worms preemptively, if you might not be a terrible
thing
idea.
To do, because it does offer different procedures that people can take to mitigate the fee.
Exactly.
And maybe that would be, do a quick recap of, here's how we got where we are, and then have someone from, Doug used to do it.
Doug used to do it,
or he designed it.
Right.
But perhaps have somebody from DPW make the basis of it after a basic explanation be, here's how to mitigate the fee with rain gardens, with, you know, drainage, with this and that. Because a lot of time wasn't spent on that, I don't think, probably.
Well, I think that itself.
That'd be a real service.
Just to be sure folks understand what the mitigations are, what the categories of exemption are, and yeah.
I don't think
that's widely understood.
I've never applied for it, but since the fee came in, I have put in, you know, systems to deal with stormwater in my parking areas that I didn't have before, but I've never applied for an abatement, but I did put them in, and people might like to know what they can do to...
Well, maybe we can figure out whether you're eligible for an abatement.
Well, I would be if I bothered filling out the forms. I just haven't got around to me yet. But basic homeowners, you know, that gives them a way to at least mitigate the fee. If we sort of are agreeing it's not going away, we're going to re-explain why it's here, and then say, and here's a little tutoring on how you might mitigate the amount of fee that you have to pay based on affordable thing. You know, you're not going to put in a dry well with a storm drain in your driveway, but you may want to do a water garden, you may want to do this or that. Help yourself out a little bit.
I just want to point out that I think it's in the code of ordinances that the DPW needs to, or the mayor needs to submit on behalf of the DPW, a credit policy every year. We haven't done that yet this year, but it's already overdue. So.
From my understanding from the mayor, that's in the offing. They were a little bit, same with the presentation, that was supposed to happen on an annual basis, and we got the first one.
We got 2 years worth.
For a variety of reasons, and I think the same thing, you're right. But we haven't had that scheduled. We have had those presentations in the past, but mm-hmm. last year we got a
presentation. Maybe we'll get here in time to send it to this meeting. For
right, it was due in January, basically.
Would make it more than just start talking about it. We'd actually have a plan on the table to talk about it.
Right. So to be perfectly frank, I don't think the mayor would be overly enthused if we talked about opening this can of worms. I think it would make him a little anxious. But at the same time, I think it's a conversation that's being had outside these chambers. It's in if we're going to be a representative body, we shouldn't ignore it.
And this would be the logical place.
Especially if he sends that plan,
yeah,
then it would come here, and that would be a basis for that meeting, right. And why we're opening the Pandora's box, as it were.
Or the can of worms, or whatever.
Whatever we want to call it, yeah.
Pam has to clean it up, whatever it is. You spill it all over the floor.
Right.
I'm good at that.
Yes. That's why she gets a big bucks.
Okay. Well, no, I'm convinced. Makes sense. Councilor Nash, you have anything to add?
I love Director LaScaglia's presentation at the last meeting. I thought it was really informative, especially when you see that the fee's been used all over the city. You know, that it's not just about stormwater getting to the Connecticut River, it's about stormwater getting under our roadways. And so wherever you are in town, you can get from one side of town to the other. And so I think that would be an important part of this discussion and the presentation.
Especially for the people who were lucky enough this year to get their streets redone. And part of that fee will be used to do the stormwater component of that. So
in conjunction with Columbia Gas.
With Columbia Gas, and with the water enterprise and the sewer enterprise, and brand new gas pipes and sidewalks in some places.
I saw plenty of evidence that the money is going to good projects that are needed all over the city. And so.
No, I agree. That was a very important part of that presentation.
Well, and I do think that a lot of the people who are, that from what I've heard, people who have the biggest issue with the fee are not within the flood control system downtown. And they're kind of like, well, my water doesn't go down there. It goes to another town entirely. And my water just goes into the ground or down that stream over there. You know, why me? And I think they need to see why you, because your road would get washed out if we didn't rebuild that culvert. So, and we've been doing that.
Right. This credit policy is supposed to come annually. What all does that report? What are we expecting that to consist of?
They basically break down the amount of abatements that were awarded and what they were awarded for. Redefine, would describe the formula for calculation, the calculus, and the purposes to, you know, what and I think also included is, as you make adjustments in those abatements, we still need to accumulate the same amount of money. How does that impact all the other fees? Mm-hmm. And as I recall, I think that's about it, right?
It's a pretty extensive document. It's right on the DPW's website.
The last one.
Yeah. I can send you the link to it.
Okay, correct.
Yeah.
And that's that's a for our information.
Yeah, it was actually mandated in the legislation.
There's no action.
No.
We have to vote to accept.
We have to vote to accept it.
Yeah. We vote to accept the report, but yeah. We can't change it.
Last year, was that accepted? Was a recommendation from this committee made to accept it by the council? Is that the way it worked procedurally?
I'm sorry, I don't understand.
Well, if the council is to accept that report.
Right.
Did it come through this committee on the way to council acceptance?
No, it just came directly to the council, as I recall. I don't recall it coming through this committee.
I think Jim LaRilla did a presentation to the entire council.
Right.
Okay. So I'll talk to Mayor about that in terms of what the timing is and how. What manner you would see that being presented this year.
I just wanted to ask the question though, is there something in the works about the stormwater fees changing?
I am not aware that there's any great desire to go back and change the formulas, change the system. I don't know if that's what we're talking about.
There's frequent conversations about what's about if there is some glaring problem that needs to be addressed that might require a modification of the formula. So far, nothing's triggered that yet. It's close in some cases. I mean, there was discussion about conservation land, or particularly land in the meadows, which is former Councilor Jim Dostal had argued that in the event of a flood emergency, our actually emergency discharge goes into the meadows. So they are arguing, well, why should we have to pay into a system that's going to destroy us? So there's been some discussion about, and we did make some adjustments for that, but there may be something
Yeah, their formula was for contiguous parcels, you know, if you own 25 acres and it's five contiguous parcels, are you gonna get five bills for each parcel or one for the whole 20 acre contiguous? I mean, that was part of the compromise made with those guys, was you're not gonna get five bills, you're gonna get one bill for everything.
But if there were any changes, that would come by way of the mayor submitting.
Well, or a counselor can do it through a sponsored proposal.
Would it be an amendment to the original ordinance?
It would be, yes, it would be a modification amendment to the original ordinance. So.
Okay. But to your question, I'm not aware that there's any, as of right now, any particular proposal to do that.
No, there's just been a group in the public who's called for repeal.
Right.
Entirely. Right.
So I'm not sure that you knew this, but we did the water and sewer rates public hearing. We did two of them last year. One was the last day of February, which was February 29th last year, and then we did that in this group. Mm-hmm. And then we did financed it on too.
But they get to be submitted.
Right.
So we don't have them to chew on yet.
Remember, we were changing the formula last year too. So it was that was a real big deal.
Yeah.
Right. So
that gives you a sense of timing.
Well, exactly. So which is why if they're submitted, and if they in time to go to council for referral here, we would be dealing with them next month here.
Well, yeah.
Right.
Next month is Thursday, right?
Well,
yeah.
I mean, our next meeting of this committee, our February meeting of this committee.
February 16th, they would have to come to council for you to get them on your agenda for February. Mm-hmm.
Right.
It's sooner than we think.
Right. So I'll go back to Mayor and talk about the timetable on water and sewer rates and on the stormwater credit plan. Okay, so that would mean, going back to just roughing out our next two or three meetings, that February is, as we've discussed, gas leaks and gas moratorium, and possibly water sewer public hearing. And then, if it's not in February, then March, it would be a March public hearing, I guess. Although that could start to cramp the timetable.
Well, the whole budget's going to be showing up for May, so yeah. It's better to get it out of the way sooner and leave May for.
Right.
You want to come to the budget hearing?
I've now charged Council Murphy with literally tackling people and bringing them to budget hearing.
I saw in the newspaper, I was a step away from that.
Yeah. By May, it'll be leg hold traps.
They're
putting the pressure on me. Both the council president and vice president.
We're going to the courts.
Exerting unusual pressure for me to get people
here. A condition of community service for people who caught violations.
I'll call Judge Goggins. We went to high school together. Sentence him to come to the hearing.
If you want a stormwater.
Although there is provisions in the Constitution about cruel and unusual punishment. Yeah. Hang it off the hook.
If you want a stormwater abatement, you got to come to a budget.
Absolutely.
So March would be possibly water and sewer, and we'll see about when the stormwater discussion makes sense to tee up. But I'm thinking that's more likely not until April. In other words, a reversal of what.
Depending on when that comes up.
Yeah. And then in. There, Director LaScaglia still is very much interested in it turns out there is both a Public Works Week and a National Infrastructure Week, and I don't know which one.
It's crazy mayhem. It's like carnival.
It's a smorgasbord of nerdy infrastructure stuff. Take your pick, which week you want to affiliate with.
And I think that we can just follow the administration's lead, because I know they're planning something for both of those things. So I think we can just hold the signs and go rah, 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 and let administrative side put that together and just go, yeah, what they said.
That's exactly what I had in mind. I have no interest in independently trying to do something. It's just provide what we can do to promote it and give it a little visibility.
We can offer to do face painting or something like that. Or dunking booth into the sewage treatment plant.
You've done a lot of these things. Are you offering to do that one now?
Well, I'm thinking, no, we could all
that would be a fun one.
What would you pay to watch Council President Dwight dunked?
I've actually seen that come close.
So that would be in May, and we'll wait and follow.
At least it'll be warm by then.
Follow the lead.
Actually, that's always warm.
The sewage creates its own.
It's always warm down there.
Jim, here would go.
Okay.
A good turnout.
So that one will take shape over time, and we'll just support whatever else is going.
Yeah, that one. I don't think we've got to take the lead on that because I think the administration is celebrating both.
Right. So, are there any other topics coming up that folks think should be addressed in the
full plate
in our committee over the next 2-3 months? Uh oh, Councilor Nash.
You mentioned being away for one of these months. And I'm thinking stormwater fees is my first meeting the chair.
I'm thinking several.
Oh, fun.
That's true. That's not fair.
I think I'll probably be away in March, and I'm thinking stormwater would be April.
Okay.
But
all right. Well, if it happens, I'll give it a shot, and I'll have muscle around.
What's the worst that could happen?
Doug.
You can practice the gavel toss.
Chair training.
That's what I imagine. So, okay. Any other new business for the committee?
I move that we adjourn.
Is there a second?
Before we vote, I'd like to personally thank our member of the public for coming tonight.
And staying.
And again, make a plea that you come see the budget hearings.
I'm just alone. I've said a lot of moments in this room, so.
Yeah, he's getting all misty.
Was that a second?
I'll second that motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
We stand.